Hi guys, this is Jason here from the Nathaniel School of Music. In this lesson, we are going to look at five ways to improve your practice using the metronome tool. Right? All of you know the metronome tool, perhaps, if you're a musician who's been playing even for a few months, you know, this thing, right? So it basically keeps you in time because it's a very mechanical or electronic tool now. So you assume that it's absolute perfection, okay? So the first thing is when you set a metronome for a song. Right now, I have set the metronome to 94 beats per minute, which I sort of felt worked for the riff which I just about played now, which is something like... If I have to practice that with 94 BPM, with the metronome, I'm actually playing the metronome to go with my head movement. 1, 2, 3, 4. So if I actually play along with it, my head is actually going with a metronome. It's sort of syncing very well. So that is the first word of advice when you're setting the metronome for a song. Observe how the pulse is. In my case, I use my head a lot with the pulse. Some of you may use your foot. Some of you may just tap your leg or, you know, clap or whatever you snap or do whatever you want to do, right? So the metronome needs to be set ideally with the pulse of the song. Then you also feel the music better. And it's a very important step, choosing the metronome, because once you choose the metronome, you're going to do things like record the song. And when you record the first part on your DAW or recording device, you've committed to that speed, haven't you? You can't really change that. So you need to be really, really clear that 94 BPM is going to work for your song. So take the time. And what I would also recommend you to do is when you play the music, don't look at time. Play it very naturally. So if you're all alone in your house, what you could do is put on a recording app on your cell phone or something and play the riff very organically, very naturally. Once you've played the recording, you can hear it back and then use a feature which is there on most metronome apps, which is called as tap tempo. So if I use my app and just go tap tempo, try to sing. You see, it's averaging, well, to about 90, 94 beats per minute. Yeah, it's pretty much 94. Wow, that's quite cool, actually. So, average it out with a few taps. Maybe you could play about 10, 15 taps or play for about 4 bars and then see what it take the average of all your visual cues which the metronome is giving you. And yeah, that's your tempo. So don't let the metronome force the tempo out of the song. You are giving it the tempo based on what is the most natural for you. So when once you've chosen the speed of the song, you then need to practice. You then need to really feel attached to the song, and you need to feel very confident with the song. That is very, very important before you record it. So one misconception which a few people have is, why don't I make the metronome faster? If I, for example, it's 94, if I double it, so you feel a lot more relaxed, right? Because you have a lot more beats to kind of latch on to or rely on. But actually what may be happening is you're following the metronome too much, right? And you're not developing your own natural sense of timing. And then you lose the feel when you play your instrument. You lose that natural feel. For all you know, when you recorded it without the metronome, it actually sounded better. So you may not want to reduce your feel or your natural flair and make the track too robotic because you're following the click, and then people lose that sense of movement. So I would always encourage you, don't go faster. If you found that the metronome is fast, 188 BPM, if it was that, just try to move your head and you'll see how annoying it probably is, you know. 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. I don't think you'll, even the audience who hears you will move their head like that. So you need to go back to a speed which is the pulse of the song and practice with that speed. This is how your head is moving. Na 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 da 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 pam 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 pa na ta na ta da da ta ka da ga da ta ta ka ta pa da pa da. Okay, and now to further improve your timing, actually half it by 2. So now 94 divided by 2 equals 247. So now the problem is, this feels like the new pulse, right? But the music should ideally not change. It should still be. So you're probably not hearing too many beats. You're hearing like beat number 1 or beat number 3. Yeah, that's what you're hearing now, isn't it? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. Agreed? 1, 2, 3, 4. So, as you're hearing less of the beat, you're being less reliant on the click track. So, I think that's a great way to practice and improve your timing a lot more. So, you go 2, 3, 4. So, it's divided by 2. So, it's still the same song. It's still the same thing you're practicing, 94 BPM. You're just hearing a little less of it. So, you go 47 BPM. But it's actually 94 BPM. It's half, right? Go. Little tougher. But what I like about 47 is you're less reliant on the metronome and thus you play less robotic. So what you'll find in my piano playing is perhaps the dynamics of what I'm doing is growing. I'm giving better focus on my volume control. I'm giving more importance and more respect to the notes. At the same time, I have this friend which is helping me keep time. So I am reliant on the metronome, but not obsessed with it. I'm not really dependent on it so much. Right? So it's just there. It's just a guide. So that's what I like by halving, you know, so that I would advise you to do for anything you're working on. So if you've composed a lick on 100 beats per minute, practice it at 50, right? You definitely don't want to practice a lick which you composed at 100 at 200. That would be too fast. And then you're just being a slave to the metronome, which we don't want. So you could push this even further. Not by speed. You could actually push this even further by perhaps halving this even more. So what is half of 47? 23.5. But I don't have 23.5, so I'm just going to do 23. Okay. This is literally like the one of the bar, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So try to get aligned with this. And a good way to keep on time is to actually also count the subdivisions. 3 and 4 and 1 and 2. Actually counting the subdivisions helps stay on in the zone as opposed to 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. You may go a bit wrong, but 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 2 and, or you can divide by 4. 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and a 3e, 4e and a 1e and a, right? So keep that going. And once you can really feel your riff over this, then I would advise you to start playing. Or before playing, you could perhaps sing it. And when you're comfortable, right? So you see what the metronome is doing now is not the pulse. It's just a halfened version where you have less beats to work with. So what I did first was I set the metronome to go with my pulse or head movement. Then we divided it by 2. So 94 became 47, became a lot more tougher to practice. But if you ask me, a lot more inspiring to practice, because it also brings the musicality out of you when you record eventually, right? And then if you half it even more, it's like a more sporting kind of deal, you know. You're like trying to tell yourself, how good am I actually with time, you know, trying to really push yourself to the end limits of time. So that's I think something we all like to do as musicians as well. Like when you approach music in this sort of sporting way, it can give you some nice goals. It can get you, it can push you to achieve greater things, you know. So that in a nutshell is this first way of using the metronome. Let's now move on to the second way of using the metronome. Right, so with this tip or technique of using the metronome, what I do is I set the metronome to the pulse of whatever song I have composed or whatever passage of music I have prepared, and I've ended up figuring out that it is at this speed, right? This is how my head naturally moves, as I told you in the earlier clip. So you go 3, 4, 1, and then you play what you have to play with the click. It's a very triplet feel kind of groove, right? So now to improve your chops, just remember that the faster you go, it's more for the mechanical side and the muscular side in you. For example, your fingers may not be agile or adept or strong enough to take on the challenge of playing at even maybe 10 BPM faster than this. So that'll push your mechanical side, right? And you'll figure out, yeah, if I do this a bit more, yes, my fingers are going to get better and better. That's one side of the equation. The other side is to go slower. So if you go slower, you train the mind. Okay, so that's another tip while using the metronome. When you've chosen it to a certain speed, what you then want to do is go a little faster and then go a little slower. When you go a little faster, what happens is you work on the mechanics, you work on your body's physical ability to latch on to the stuff, and when you go slower, you work on your mind. So I'm going to just start by going a bit faster, maybe 65 for now. Let's see if I can actually do this. That's 65. Then you go 70. You don't want to go too fast, right? The understanding is, oh, it's going fast, so I have to now actually think of playing fast. Not really. You're still following the click or trying to follow the click. So as you will feel, it is going to work on your technique, it's going to work on the mechanics and the muscles a lot more. However, as I go slower and slower, perhaps if I practice at 50, yeah. Now to even think of that riff is a little tricky, right? Always sing before you. Playing. If I can. So you go. Actually, quite like this. So that's pretty much this second way of using the metronome. It starts the same. Even the first way started the same. Choose the correct tempo, which goes with the pulse or your head movement. In the earlier example, I was like half it again to really feel the beats better. Now what I'm advising you to do is more for developing your sense of time. So as you go faster, what will happen is you push your muscles and your technical ability. As you go slower, you push your mental ability to actually be on time. Okay, so you never know, when you go faster you may like that more, and when you go slower you may actually like that more. So delve into those possibilities and see how it goes. Let's now move to the third way of practicing with the metronome. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, so this third style of using the metronome will assume that whatever we hear is not the one of the bar. Okay, so what you heard now, whenever you hear the click, we tend to believe that it's, you know, 1, 2, or 2, 3. You believe that it's a beat. Or in the last video which we talked about, we kind of looked at it such that we say it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, where this is the 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? What I'm suggesting is don't make this the 1. This should be the 2 or the 3 or the 4 or a non-1 beat. Right now I'm on 40 BPM for your reference, and when I play it back, the composition which I had in mind was actually on 160 BPM. So if I counted 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4. This is sort of 160. 3, 4, a 1, 2. So now my tune. Is going with that sort of a feel. So I've halfened it to make my timing better, and it's at 40 right now. But I'm hearing the 1 of the bar. So what I want that to be is 2, which in hindsight is how I actually composed this riff. The metronome was at 2, and that inspired me to make what you heard now. So if I now call that as 2, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a little tricky at first. So what I would advise you to do is perhaps call that as 2, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. You may not get the timing, but you'll get it eventually. 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? 2, 3, 4, 3, 4. This sounds a lot better as well. Just feels a little bit more exciting, doesn't it? Or if it is the 3, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. You actually feel music in a very different way as you just call that 3. You know, now I'm calling it 3 and I've come up with a very random tune, but I kind of like it, you know. And if this was 4, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, consider what you hear as one. It's the two, it's the three or the four. And it can strangely enough inspire you, right? So metronome is a great tool. It's a great friend for you to have around you while you practice. It can not only help you get better as a player, it can also help you make music. And that's something I feel very strongly about this tool. Okay, let's now move into the fourth tip which I have to practice with the metronome. guys. So the fourth practice tip while using the metronome, which I have for you, is to explore accents. Now, accents are some of the coolest things you'll find in music. Everyone has used them. So I'll just give you a rundown, a small introduction. Maybe we can do a more detailed video on accents later. So what happens is, when the metronome is running, again, ideally at a very slow speed, what you need to start doing is imagine the subdivisions while the metronome is going at, in this case, 70 beats per minute. So you go 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a right E and a 2E and a 3E. So this is the pulse. My head is moving like that, sort of slow. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a... Right. So... if you were to compose music using 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a, what tends to happen would be you may come up with something like, you know, you may divide the beat structure into four equal pieces per beat. So that's 4, 4, 4, 4, 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a, or whatever, you know. It sounds nice, but it doesn't actually groove. Groove actually happens when these accents come in. So accents are basically irregular divisions of an already divided beat. So of an already divided beat system. So if the beat is divided into four, what these accents do is they'll mess it up a little bit. Instead of dividing, you're still dividing the beat by four. So listener moves to the music, but it's unpredictable because the way the notes align themselves happen in other cycles. So the passage of music which I played right now for you was 4-4-3-3-2, if I'm not mistaken. And what you can do is, if you do the math, that's 4+4+3+3+2. It still adds up to 16 16th notes, or 16 semiquavers if you want to call it that. But it's just a bit irregular. So I'm doing something like daga 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 daga. So with the way I'm voicing it now with a click, you'll find that I'm giving different importance to each beat and the relevant subbeats. So you go daga 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 daga. This is without accents, right? Daga 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 daga. Another thing we say in Indian music is we could do something like taka dhimi taka dhimi taka dhimi, where the tha is essentially the downbeat of the bar. Taka dhimi ta, or every downbeat rather. Taka dhimi taka dhimi taka dhimi. So what we're trying to do is daga 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 daga. So it's sort of like a, immediately it becomes a very vocal phrase. I'm doing 4-4-3-3-2. So I'm actually filling in a nice musical sentence, and I'm then cycling that. And I think it also makes the composition a bit more rememberable. What you could do with chords, you could also change the chord with every strong accent hit. So, 1, 2, 3, 4. So, whenever the chords change, You feel the accent a lot more. While you're practicing this with the click, pay strong attention to the accent. Also pay strong attention to the division of the beat. So you're dividing the beat into 4, 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a, and then partitioning into different beat clusters. So you go 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 4, 4, oh, 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 3, e, e, 2, oh, sorry, 3, e, e, 3, e, e, 2, right? And you also know one of the most famous songs ever written, you know, this one. He He's doing it in 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2. If you can divide 4 into 2, right? Or you can say, takit, 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 takadhimi, takit, takit, takit. It's still 16th notes. It's still dividing the beat by 4. So again, with all of the tips which I'm suggesting, try to slow your metronome down. If you observe, I've never really used a fast speed while practicing, and I think that's the way to go. Because if you want to play fast, you can play fast. You don't have to have the metronome playing fast. Right, so the fifth practice tip which I would like to share with you is where you could use some advanced tech features on these latest metronome apps which are there in the market, both on the iOS store or the Android store. So an app which I use, and I think a lot of us use in India, is called Pro Metronome. It's very stable. You can use it at gigs as well. And it has a lot of features. You can have a stage mode where you set your playlist, your song list, which has a customized metronome setup, like tempo as well as time signature. So what you could do, or what I'm going to do now in this lesson, I'm going to tell you three features of Pro Metronome and probably some other apps out there as well, which you can really use to take your practice to the next level, to inspire you, push you, and also make you sweat it out a lot. You have something called a rhythm trainer. So if I turn on rhythm trainer, and first of all, it tells me play 2 bars and mute 2 bars. So that's an interesting way to practice. What's going to happen is you play the click, it'll play for 2 bars. And then it perhaps won't play for 2 bars, which is exactly what's happening, right? So you have to be a bit good at time. Ah. Yeah. So that's a nice practice tool, which is quite a nice thing to set up for anyone. So then you also have, you can make the rhythm trainer go into random mode, absolute random, where you will be like having a sliding feature where you either mute most of the thing or you choose the metronome to play most of the thing. So I'm going to choose it somewhere 50-50 and show you what it's doing. What it's actually going to do is it'll play a little and then it'll stop whenever it wants. And then you can't like complain and say the metronome sucks, because the metronome's an electronic tool. I'm going to play it and then it's going to do all this random muting. I don't even know when it would mute. I can't even explain it to you. So that's what's cool about the random feature. Okay. Little scary, right? But a lot of fun. It can also inspire you. It becomes like a call and response kind of thing. Whenever the metronome's on, you kind of do one kind of thing or one melody. When the metronome is off, you could try and do a counter melody, change your chords, change the groove, and see how it goes. It can also, remember, with all these tools, as grueling and mind-boggling as they are, they can also be very inspiring and help you a lot with making music, which is something you should also be aware of while you're using it. Okay, the second Sort of advanced version of the metronome is where you can set up your practice. So what I like to do is they have this thing called an automator. So it tells you every 2 bars increase by something, or every X amount of bars increase by something, what will be your start tempo and what will be your max tempo. So I'm going to be like every 2 bars increase by 7 beats per minute, which you can adjust here. The start tempo and the max tempo is 150. There we go. 95, okay? Getting faster, right? So that's mode number two, where you automate it. So it's just nicer for the when you practice, you sort of feel a gradual. This was a bit sudden because I just wanted to show you all quickly. But in an actual practice, you'll probably increment by about 2 BPM or 5 BPM every 4 or 8 bars. So that way you finally reach your goal. But then you don't be like, ah, I have to do it. I have to do it. Can I do it? You know, you're not thinking about your skill. You're just playing it naturally and just letting it kind of push you to the final level. Sort of like a music teacher teaching you drums or something, right? Okay. And the third way of using the third advanced feature on this metronome app would be the subdivisions. So if I use subdivisions over, let's say, 80 BPM, you know, you have these subdivisions which could go 8th notes, triplets, like a shuffle, swing feel, or semi-quavers. Or maybe a permutation of semi-quavers, which is like 1E and 2E and 3E and 2E and taka, 1E and a 2E and a 3E. So it's quite interesting because that itself is sort of like a groove you could adapt some music over. I hope that makes sense. These are 5 ways to practice with the metronome. So moving forward, what I'd advise you to do is check out the description. Very important to check out the description. You will find all the pieces of music which I played. Go through them, jam along. I've also taught the harmonic and the other stuff in the link. So check that out. And also stay tuned or follow through to the next video. Once you've sort of assimilated this information on how to practice the metronome to actually be creative and compose. Okay, so that's what we are going to also share. So please be aware of that lesson as well. Okay, so in this video, we watched 5 ways of doing the metronome to practice. Let's just recap. First of all, we slowed the thing down. And we slowed it down always by half and then half of that half. Then we went a bit faster to push our muscles. We went slower to push our mind. Then what did we do in the third instance? We tried to practice specific beats where you feel only the non-one of the bar. You're feeling beat 2, beat 3 or beat 4. So I showed you in this example how we felt beat 2 for the most part. Then in example 4 or 4th way to practice, I've used the metronome at a fairly slow speed but used irregular accent patterns. For example, 4 plus 4 plus 3 plus 3 plus 2 to develop some interesting musical phrases. And in the 5th practice methodology, I've taken the metronome and just explored some of its advanced features, if you will. So have fun with this and do stay tuned to our YouTube channel for a lot more videos. You can head over to the playlists where we've organized all our content quite quite well. There's some of my music as well. If you like some of my tunes or some of my compositions, you can head over to the channel and please subscribe. And more importantly, turn on that bell icon for notifications. When you do that, whenever we release a new lesson or a new song or a new riff, you'll get an update and you could consider watching it. And do share this channel as well with all your musician friends. We have a lot of things for beginners. We have stuff for advanced people. We have things for producers and so on and so forth. And our school, Nathaniel School of Music, is now a very online music school. We do a lot of these short courses on various topics as well as workshops. So if any of you would like to learn, we are leaving our email ID in the description, which is music@nathanielschool.com. You could just write to us, tell us what you'd like to learn, and we could then inform you whenever these things happen, right? So again, thanks for your patience watching this video, and I hope you have a lot of fun with the metronome. Please make sure you have fun with it first. Don't look at just using it, oh, I have to practice, I have to get better. No, just do it to have fun. Enjoy yourself, and then the metronome will start being your friend, and then you can really rely on it when you practice and compose music. See you in the next video. Cheers.